got a tiger by the tail.
Some people play back of the beat, real laid back. Others play kind of medium, we get right in the middle. I played up on top of whatever the top was. I just felt it like that.
Looks like I've got a tiger by the tail.
That sound was called the Bakersfield sound because of those musicians living and working there in nightclubs. But ironically, the sound that was the Bakersfield sound was recorded for the most part in Hollywood at the beautiful Stacker Records building over on Vine Street, the Capitol Records Tower.
It was here that the unique talent of record producer Ken Nelson was instrumental in Buck Owens' success.
What made Buck a great performer was that he loved the public, number one. And he felt that he was giving them something. And he would get out there and just wow the audience.
When Buck and those guys went in to record those songs, the music had a very immediate connection to those honky-tonks and dance halls because they were playing them the following Thursday and Friday and Saturday nights again. And they were writing some of those songs on the way to and from those shows.
They're gonna put me in the movies. They're gonna make a big star out of me.
We would get to the studio, and he knew what sound he wanted. He knew what kind of arrangement he wanted. He was the whole, he was Buck Owens.
To his knowledge, of all the records I ever made for him, he never heard one of them before I recorded it. He never knew if I was going to bring three trombones and a Salvation Army drum.
Ken Nelson's hands-off approach was the very opposite of the Nashville system, and it gave Bakersfield freedom to create its unique style. It had many followers.
The Beatles were fans of Buck, and they would—they asked me to send them dubs of everything that Buck recorded. If I recorded a session with Buck, I would send it to the Beatles. And let me see, they recorded one of his songs, Act Naturally, I believe. But they were fans of Buck.
They were Little Richard things, Chuck Berry things, and Buck Owens things. You know, I thought, man, what nice company that is.
2, 3, 4. All I gotta do is act naturally.
The music scene in Bakersfield essentially grew out of the western migration of the Okies from Oklahoma, primarily in the Midwest, after the Dust Bowl. They were country people, and they took their music with them.
The Dust Bowl past of the Okies was given voice by another great Bakersfield artist, Merle Haggard.
It's a big job just getting by with 9 kids and a wife. Yeah, but I've been a working man, dang near all my life, and I'll keep on working.
I think Merle Haggard was the next Hank Williams because he was the most articulate songwriter, the voice of that generation. You know, Bob Dylan was the voice of the college student's generation. Merle Haggard was the voice of the working man. You know, how do you survive day to day? He spoke for those people.
Mama's Hungry Eyes was written about a period in America where there were places like labor camps. And there was a lot of people that was in these labor camps that weren't ignorant, and they weren't a lot of things that Steinbeck thought they were. My aunt and Uncle Esker lived in a canvas-covered cabin beside the railroad track in Houston, California. And I got to visit them once in a while and really get to know those people and see the impact that the Depression had on them. And Mama's Hungry Eyes probably tells that story best. A canvas-covered cabin
in a crowded labor camp, stand out in this memory I revive.
'Cause my daddy raised a family there with two hard-working hands, and tried to feed my mama's hungry eyes. He dreamed of something better, and my mama's faith was strong, and us kids were just too young to realize that another class of people put us somewhere just below. One more reason for my mama's hungry eyes. Oh, I still recall my mama's hungry eyes.
When I first started to record Merle, I became so enamored with his singing that I would forget what else was going on. And I suddenly, hey, wait a minute, there's a musician here that you've got to worry about. But his songs, he was a great writer.
Merle Haggard drew inspiration from every aspect of his life.
My dad passed away when I was 9. And I don't know if you've ever thought about somebody you've lost, and you say, I wonder what so-and-so would think about this. And I was driving on Interstate 40, saw a sign said 19 miles to Muskogee. Muskogee was always referred to in my childhood as back home. So I saw that sign on my whole childhood flashed before my eyes, and I thought, I wonder what Dad would think about the youthful uprising that was occurring at the time, the Janis Joplins, and you know, and I understood him, I got along with it, but I thought, what if he was to come alive at this moment? And I thought, what a way to describe the kind of people in America that are still sitting in the center of the country saying, what is going on these campuses?
We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. We don't take our trips on LSD. We don't burn our draft cards down on Main Street. 'Cause we like living right and being free.
The song struck a chord with the diehard traditional audience of the Country Music Association.
We like holding hands.
But somehow it also appealed to younger fans, like the crowd at the Armadillo in Austin.
We don't let our hair grow long and shaggy.
We all sang it. We adopted it. It was kind of funny. You know, it was like we knew Merle better than that.
I'm proud to be an Okie from Muskogee. Place where even squares can have a fall. We still wave old glory down. In Muskogee, Oklahoma, USA.
Merle Haggard was also a surprisingly inspirational presence for another much younger California-based performer, Gram Parsons, whose Flying Burrito Brothers were early pioneers of country rock. Gram Parsons was passionate about country music's simple poetry. He was equally passionate about rock music. At a time when they were poles apart, he alone thought they belonged together. His songs and his voice had an almost childlike vulnerability.
Graham was a good songwriter who, if he'd lived another 3 or 4 years, would have been a great songwriter.
'Cause I'm the one who showed you how to do the things you're doing now.
I really do believe that there probably never would have been a country rock movement if there hadn't been Graham Parsons. And there wouldn't have been Linda Ronstadt. There wouldn't be the Eagles. There would possibly not have been a Fleetwood Mac.
No, I wouldn't lie.
There might not have been some of the Rolling Stones music.
You know I'm not.
And there wouldn't have been an Emmylou Harris.
In his brief solo career, Graham Parsons' affinity for country found its fullest expression in his duets with Emmylou Harris.
I would say until I met Graham and started working with him, didn't really understand or have a real love or a feel for country music. Like most of my generation, you know, country music was politically incorrect for us at that point. It was associated with Republicans and right wing and that sort of thing. He taught me the beauty in the poetry, the simplicity, the honesty in the music. And the love of harmony came from really singing with him.
Love hurts, love scars, love wounds and marks any heart, not tough, no.
When I listen to Graham Parsons sing with Emmylou, I feel the kind of melancholy that only comes from youthful innocence. It was not just music of the jaded and whiskey-soaked. It was also able to be the music of the disillusioning experiences of youth.
It came very naturally. Graham really didn't have to tell me what to do. I was Ginger Rogers to his Fred Astaire. I mean, he was leading and I was following, but it just was as natural as breathing.
No one will ever know what Graham's collaboration with Emmylou could have achieved. In 1973, just before the release of his second album, Graham was found dead of a drug overdose in the Joshua Tree Motel, California. He was 26 years old. His story ended with a macabre twist.
Graham's road manager had made a pact with Graham that whichever one of them died first, the other would cremate his body at Joshua Tree, the place they loved in the desert there. They stole a hearse, drove out into the desert, all drunk as church mice, and set the body and the coffin on fire. But it didn't burn completely, and I think police started arriving and they fled and left what was partially burned of Graham. It was a very, certainly one of the oddest ends to a country star we've ever seen.
Emmylou Harris was now committed to country and picked up where Graham Parsons had left off.
My whole artistic life was bound up in working with him, and that's all I really wanted to do. So I had to figure out a way. It was almost like, well, what would Graham do?